and welcome to the People's Art. My name's Melissa Latouche and I'll be looking after you for this show. Now, we're enjoying receiving all of your work, but we still need some more, so send them to the same email address below on the screen. We have got a fun-packed show for you today. We have our guest here, Jean Parker, who does painting on crop circles, and also we have many videos that you've been sending in, and of course, the Viewers Gallery. Hello, Jean.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
I've had a look at your website, and you've got an abundance of work there, done in so many different mediums. Now, one reoccurring theme that I saw was the use of nature, expressions of nature. Mm. Would you say that statement's correct?
Absolutely. I do like to... I spend a lot of time looking at nature, and I do like to express the colours that I've seen in the day when I come home at night, and you know, the next day I get inspired by the nature that I see, and I basically want to reproduce it in my own style.
How do you get your inspiration?
Well, sometimes it's just walking down the road or driving past something. You know, you just see an image, it stays in your mind, and you suddenly think, I want to do something with that image. And so therefore I just, sometimes I let myself free flow. I don't always sit down to paint a particular thing. Sometimes I just let it happen. And quite often when that happens, I end up with a tree.
So let's rewind a little bit.
Okay.
And get to know a bit about your background and what led you to this type of art that we're going to see.
Well, I've always been a painter, a drawer, ever since I was small. I'm self-taught. I'd done a little bit of academia, but I didn't really follow through on the academic sort of line. It's always been my passion to create things, you know, and to paint and draw, and I also make mosaic as well, so I've got my finger in many pots, so to speak. But it's just, like I say, it's my passion. It's not that I don't have to drive myself to do it, it's what I choose to do with my time, and I always have done ever since I was a child. I get lost in my art. When I paint, everything else goes out the window. I'm just focused on what I'm doing. I'm in the zone, and everything else can fall down around me. I have to sort of stop myself sometimes and take a check on what's actually happening in my domestic life, you know. And
so tell me a bit about the mediums that you use. You mentioned mosaic.
Yeah, I do mosaics. I don't do that often because it's quite heavy on the wrists. Because you're cutting all the time, all your pieces. But I also work with acrylics, watercolours and gouache. I'd done a couple of oils, but I don't really get on very well with the smell of the linseed and stuff. I find it a bit difficult. I particularly like at the moment painting with watercolours and gouache because they're so easy. They're mobile. You can carry them out and you can use them wherever you want to use them. Acrylics are a bit more of a studio thing really, but I am prolific and I paint pretty much every day. I did actually give myself, I don't know if you'd call it a challenge, but I sort of gave myself this thing of creating something every day. It was like something I took on. I'm going to create something every day, even if that thing that you created is a tidy house. Or cleaning out your studio or whatever, your space, to create more stuff. But to be creative every day was like my mantra, you know.
When we were having a chat before we started the show, you were telling me a bit about your history in following around bands, doing face painting at festivals. tell the viewers a bit
about
that.
In the 70s, I left home in 1973, I think it was. I was 16, and I used to go to a lot of free festivals around England and Wales, and during that time I met a band called Here and Now, who was also on the festival circuit, and so I travelled with them for quite some time, a couple of years, and of course during that time meeting lots of other musicians and other artists, and became a sort of an alternative type of circus, if you like, you know, that sort of thing. We're all travelling together, doing what we do, creating, making music, sometimes building a stage, making the whole thing happen. Sometimes it wasn't until we arrived that the festival started, because up until that point there wasn't a band or, you know, a PA even, you know. So we used to do that, travel around the country, getting stopped by the police all over the place because for some reason they thought that we were up to no good, you know. But we didn't have much. We were doing it on the little bit of money we had, and was driven by our passion. For me was to be creative and to do stuff with paint. For them was to make the music. So I would spend a lot of time face painting and making backdrops and doing album covers and things like that, you know. So that kept my sort of artistic hand in through the 70s. And then at the end of the 70s, I actually joined a band myself for a short time. I wasn't with them for the whole duration. We done one tour, and I designed half of their album cover, which has actually just been re-released. So I just recently had to do some more work where I had to write in the same style that I did in the 70s, which was, it was all right, but it was just quite strange to go back in time. So that was the 80s by then, and I think I left the band in, it was probably 1980 itself. And then I just started to get more involved with my own life. And I suppose I was getting near to the age where I wanted to start having children and stuff like that. So these
periods that you developed your art in, it must have been very inspirational for you.
It was incredibly inspirational because, you know, you would just meet strangers. And the next thing you know, you're working together with these strangers to create some sort of happening, whether it's a piece of art or a performance, you know, or just a happening with people that are either dancing or doing some sort of expression, theatrical or whatever.
What's one of your most inspiring creations?
I don't think I've got anything that I've made that is particularly more inspiring than others. There's things that I like. Mm. When I create a piece of art, sometimes I get attached to it.
Yeah.
And it takes about a year and a half before I'm ready to sell it, because I get so attached to it. And then I find that in order to sell it, you've got to bring it into monetary value, and I find that incredibly difficult. Mm. And of course, when I first make a piece of art, I'm quite passionate about that piece. Well, of course, that passion dwindles in time because you're then going on to make your next piece or the piece after that. So it
becomes
diluted.
Are you making a full-time living out of the art that you...
I'm scraping by.
Yeah.
I'm not really making a proper living, but I've chosen to live with less and do what I enjoy doing with life rather than to do something I don't enjoy doing, to bring in more money, to buy things that really don't mean much to me. I mean, as long as I've got food and my rent's paid and I've got clothes on my back and I can go off and do a few things in the year, then I'm quite happy. But
is there a message that you want to convey, or how do you want people to relate to your work?
Well, it's always nice to see somebody be inspired by your work and very attracted. And I have got a few fans out there that like my work. And I've sold a few pieces, obviously, over the time. But as far as a message, I don't really have a particular message to convey. I mean, I have loads of messages to convey. Don't frack. Don't use fur. You know, don't go to war. Drop arms. You know, like, pay your taxes. All of that stuff. I'm really big on all of that stuff.
Do you feel like art is like healing?
Art's very healing. I find that I feel very meditative when I paint.
Mm.
And like I say, I don't always have control of what happens. Sometimes I just let it happen and see what, you know, I can just go into a bit of a mad space and I just come out with all this colour. Then I can see if it inspires me to do anything else with it. Mm. Sometimes it's actually a piece in its own right, you know. Mm. I've got a few pieces. There's one piece in particular that turned out like that, which is a piece that has got a ram's head in it that you've got in your collection.
Okay.
That was completely spontaneous. It just came out without me trying to actually make anything. It just manifested.
Do you prepare before you paint, or is there anything that you do before you paint?
I like to have a tidy space.
Yeah.
The first thing I do is tidy up so that I don't actually, nothing else is calling me, so that I can give myself to my work when I do it. With certain subjects, I mean, sometimes I done a large picture of a Jagannath Rath Yatra, and that was because I went to this amazing celebration, and then the next thing I wanted to do the next morning was paint it. So I do get inspired like that, and then I worked on that painting for a month afterwards. And that's sort of similar like the crop circles, really. You see something and then you get inspired to paint it. But with a lot of my art, it's not really inspired by one particular thing. Sometimes it's just a feeling. Sometimes I just want to work with reds and yellows in a day.
Yeah.
Sometimes I just go to I've gone for a massive blue period where everything I done was just using one blue paint, but with various depths of that colour, you know. And sometimes I get a buzz out of doing that, you know, making lots of colours from one colour.
Mm.
That in itself is a project that I enjoy, you know.
Thank you very much, Jean. We'll be talking to you a bit later about the rest of your paintings here.
Okay.
Right now, we're off to a video of Ben Wilson, also known as the Chewing Gum Man, and we'll be following his trail on the Millennium Bridge. Enjoy.
People know me as the Chewing Gum Man, and for the last, well, 3.5-4 months I've been doing a trail of pictures across the Millennium Bridge. So I'm working on people's discarded chewing gum, and it allows for art to happen in a random capacity. So it's a hidden trail of pictures, and I've started on the Tate Modern side, and I'm trying to work my way to those pools. So I've done about 2/3 of the bridge. And the pictures, they come out of the environment in which they're created in. So the picture's often inspired by the shape of the gum, which has melted into the tread of the Millennium Bridge itself. But also the pictures can have a social element, that people come up to me and ask me what I'm doing, and often they'll ask me to do pictures for them. And that's interesting because the pictures then reflect the people in the environment in which they created it. I suppose I believe in spontaneity and allowing something to happen in a random capacity, because the gum isn't owned by anyone, so it's a forum where then art can take place. I can bypass bureaucracy, I don't have to get permission from anyone to do the work. And there was one picture which was of St. Paul's Cathedral, and it had the people walking on the bridge. And a number of people came up to me, "Where's that picture? Where's it gone?" And I had to just say, "Well, it's been destroyed." And even the police, one of the policemen, first of all, they saw me doing the picture and they weren't sure, and they took all my details. But then a couple of weeks later, they came back and he said, "Oh, I'm just coming to show a colleague the St. Paul's picture." And then he saw it and he really loved it. And then when he came back, he was shaking me by the hand, you know. So various people were actually looking for the picture and they couldn't find it. So it was about 4.5 to 5 hours work. So. But in saying that, it's the process of exploration, what I like with the art, and however many pictures get destroyed, then I just do more. And we'll see what happens. But it's interesting because the pictures are working on a number of levels. There's some which are so small, and then you think that people won't see them, but then I look online and then I say, "Oh God, that someone's seen that picture because it's been photographed." And there's some really sweet ones, because it's an element that something's quite hidden is what I like, because then people then can have their own process of they can actually discover the picture for themselves, and then they have their own relationship with the picture that they're encountering. Thank you.
was wonderful. Keep that work coming in, and we'll be back after the break with some more of your work.
open up your mind and I bet you've been reading between the lines. Do I see what you see looking through your eyes? It's a peel back the layers off looking for life. So I've been harvesting sin. I got more than enough for us both to begin. Lay to rest all your trouble and take this man and we'll sin through the trouble of another's hand. Another game, hope they're wrong. Blood-soaked sand, yeah, the dust begins to settle in the palm of your hand. The tale of a town where folks are insane and they won't try to kill me when they hear my name. Call my name. Since we met, I've been holding up your mind in a bit.
If you'd just like to open your mouth wide and say, ah!
Truth lies within nature.
Oh, thanks, Matt. You got a lighter on you at all?
Thank you. Can you see him? Falling. Falling. Falling through a silent sky. Catch him if you can. Upon that innocent, making a living upon their father's land. That drones are flying now, destination blood and sand. The spider in its web of whispers weaves a web of deceit, where the truth has become a lie to believe in, and freedom, well, that's obsolete. Collateral damage is an innocent man. This corruption of a sovereign land. Who answers for this crime? Catch that angel falling before the end of time. The judge and the jury are sofa sitting, only a care away. Comfy, not seeing, believing what the papers say. There is no fear outside their window, and everything is fine. What they think is freedom is a global corporate crime. But what if, what if, what if that fear was upon their window? Fear from that drone strike. Deliberations would be over then, with a judgment as quick as you like. But with liberty lost, freedom is owned, and we may soon all wake up in the land of the drone. For time's running out, but it is not too late. But we would do well to remember an opinion will matter not in a totalitarian state. So catch that angel falling. Catch him if you can. Reach for the sky with liberty in your hand. For if that angel be fallen, if he falls upon mortal man, we will have to lock our windows tightly then. For the devil will walk the land.
Thank you.
We'll be back after this break with Jean to take a look at some of her paintings of crop circles. Welcome back. We're here with Jean and we're going to talk a bit about her paintings on crop circles. Hi, Jean.
Hi, Melissa.
Let's look at this painting first of all. Tell me a little bit about the process of the painting.
Well, it's Silbury Hill. It's around the Silbury area in Wiltshire. Well, I just sort of saw it and was instantly attracted to the design because of the sun and moon. I really like the combination of sun and moon, so I instantly felt inspired to paint this. It took me probably about 4 days to do it properly because I have to sit and look at it for a while before I complete.
So how did you come about painting crop circles? Where did it first start?
Well, it first started in 1989. I'd seen the Alton Barnes crop circle and I was really inspired. That was the long key shaped one. I was really inspired by it, so I thought, oh, I'm going to put it on some t-shirts. So I started to paint crop circles on t-shirts. And then as my friends got more and more involved in the whole crop circle phenomena and stuff, you know, we got a little bit more interested in it and I started to decide to do a few proper paintings of it because, you know, it was, the whole subject was warranting a lot more sort of focus and investigation. And while I was thinking about these crop circles and how they appear and everything, I just thought, well, let's just do a few images of the ones that I particularly were drawn to, which were mostly the ones that were in Wiltshire.
Mm.
Because they're the ones basically that I managed to get to visit. I didn't visit all of the circles that I've painted, but I've visited an awful lot of crop circles. Good. Over the years.
And how did you paint this? Is it from memory, photo?
Or? No, this was done directly from a photo, as were all the others, well, most of the others actually. They were taken directly from photos, but because I knew the area, I felt sort of like, I felt familiar with the picture right from the off. And this, as you can see here, that's West Kennet. And that's a place that I've actually visited on numerous occasions and I actually really like it there. So I was really enjoying creating this because of my familiarity with the area.
Now let's look at the rest of your work.
Okay.
So this painting here, was it also done in Wiltshire?
Yeah, I think this one's Wiltshire. I think it's near to Swindon. It's obviously a crop circle that's been made in a field of rapeseed.
Okay.
It's on quite a high hill. This is actually the brow of the hill there, with the distance going off. I didn't actually visit this one, but I just was inspired by basically the rapeseed colour. I thought it looked fantastic, the picture.
In your opinion, what do you believe the meaning of crop circles are?
Well, the meaning of crop circles. Well, one thing I do know about crop circles is that they make us think outside the box,
yeah,
which I think is a good thing to happen. The other thing that I've liked to see, that I've enjoyed seeing in crop circles is scientists and bankers and hippies and dinner ladies and everybody all talking together inside the crop circle, trying to suss out where's it come from, what's it about and everything. I mean, to me, it's a mystery. I don't think I'm ever going to be able to actually know exactly what it is that has made a crop circle. But they are fascinating and there's something quite enjoy about, but about the mystery of them.
Yeah.
I think we all like a mystery. And the crop circles have definitely caused a stir anyway over the last few years.
If you had to guess, or what do you feel like?
Obviously, some of them are man-made.
Yeah.
Something like this could be easily man-made. But then you get other ones, like this one below, that are much more intricate. Geometrically, they're just so precise. And then, you know, you get the aerial views of them, and they become totally three-dimensional. Now, I can't see that being man-made overnight in such a short time. It's got to involve something else, but what that something else is, I can't. Yes. I mean, you know, it could be aliens. People are saying it could be the mycelii. It could be any of these things, but I don't know any answers. I've got no answers about it. I just like the intriguing mystery of the whole crop circle phenomena.
So what led you to paint them? Is it that you're saying the mystery? Is there more to that?
Well, what happened was as I was doing the T-shirts in the beginning, obviously the interest in crop circles was growing at that time. And so I was getting lots of orders for T-shirts and whatnot. And a couple of people asked me for some particular paintings of particular crop circles, pictures they'd taken themselves. This collection here I made for a crop circle convention that I went to in Marlborough College a couple of years back. And this is what I've got left from the collection that I took. I think I took about 8 pieces originally.
Okay.
And I've got these left. So yeah, that's why I've done them.
Let's go down to the next one. This is a more intricate one.
This one is also another part of Wiltshire. I'm not quite sure which part of Wiltshire it is, to be honest, but I just particularly like the composition of this photo, and I thought that the crop circle itself was quite interesting because it seemed so intricate. I just decided to see if sort of I quite like the challenge of seeing if I could do it, and
you pulled it off.
I enjoyed doing it. Thank you.
So let's look at the other two that you have here.
These two, I've got no idea where they were.
What attracted you to paint this one?
Well, I particularly got drawn to this one because of the lay of the crop on the floor. It seems to be going in different directions, and I wanted to sort of try and capture that as much as I could, really. I think that was the thing that drew me to paint this one, was because the others don't seem to be showing that quite so strongly as this one does.
What do these paintings or expressions mean to you?
Well, I don't know. What do they mean to anyone? They mean mystery, don't they? They bring in mystery because nobody's got the answer to crop circles and where they've come from. So to me, it just brings up the whole mystery and the phenomena of the whole happening, and I find that exciting.
Yeah. I noticed in your on your website that you do mandalas. You work a lot with nature.
Mm-hmm.
tell me a bit about what's drawn you to that sort of work.
Well, nature, it's all around us, isn't it? It inspires me on a daily basis. So, you know, when you see that something's happened in nature that's out of the normal, especially something like a crop circle, then it sort of inspires you to capture it in some way and make your own, you know, image of it. And, I wonder what is going on beneath the roots of that crop.
and when, because you've been painting them, obviously it takes a lot of focus. Do you feel that there's a sacred geometry?
I find geometry quite fascinating anyway, being an artist, you know, angles and everything. But with the crop circles, some of it is, you know, when it's done on number fives or number sevens or 11s, you know, it seems to be so intricate. And I know people that are into this sort of stuff, and they tell me how cosmic some of them are as opposed to some of the others. I find them all intriguing in different ways, you know. What I like most about crop circles is it just makes your mind think a little bit more, delve a little bit more, go out of the box, you know, and ask questions. And I think that as a human race, we need to ask more questions about what's going on around us, you know. So. I think it's fantastic.
Sorry. I've heard that there is communication behind these crop circles. Now, what do you think are the symbols, or what do you think that there's an actual communication going on through these?
I don't know. Maybe not. There were some crop circles that appeared in the past that looked like a sort of like an alphabet, but it's not no alphabet that I've ever seen, you know, but it looks like it's some sort of written word. Who knows? Who knows whether it's for real or it's just a sort of flight of fancy? We just don't know, you know, but I do know that some of my friends have felt that particular crop circles have spoken to them louder than others for whatever reason, either to do with the shape or the vibration or the placement or for various reasons, you know,
Thank you, Jean, so much for chatting with us today.
You're welcome.
Now we're off to the gallery. Amazing work being sent in there. Keep that work coming in. It's been amazing talking with Jean today, and we will see you next week.